And this was what requires more, let's say, explanation. Le'olam yadur adam be'eretz Yisrael. One should always live in Eretz Yisrael. Afilu be'ir sheruba ovdei kochavim. Even in a city which is majority idol worshippers. One should live, the preference is to be in Eretz Yisrael, even with the negative surroundings, idol worship, idolaters, which is the exact, right, the antithesis of Torah, the oneness of God. It's better to be in Eretz Yisrael, even in a city full of idol worshippers. Va'al yadur, and one should not live b'chutzlat, outside the land, afilu be'ir sheruba Yisrael, even in a city which is majority Jewish, with all the positive influence. Which is a better influence on your children? Maybe you're strong. But a neighborhood, a community, a land that is full of idol worshippers or Jews? Where is it better to live? You know, what kind of question? Obviously, among Jews, the yeshiva, the schools. But if it means America or Israel, one should always live in Eretz Israel, even in a city. Even, obviously it's not good. But even, again, it supersedes that value of the education. One rabbi writes that, Rav Moliver. And Shiva Tzion writes that, even with the negative influence that might take place, I have to be careful with this, but this is what the rabbis say here so far. Even in a city which is full of idol worshippers, and not to be in Chutzlat, in a community that is full of Torah and full of Jews. Where do you learn that out from? The Gemara brings the source. Shekol, excuse me, not the source yet. Why is that so? Shekol hadar be'eretz Yisrael domeh kemishlo yeshlo eloka. For all those that live in Eretz Yisrael, as if they have a God. Here is where you're with God. Here you have a God. V'kol adar b'chutz la'aretz domeh k'misha eino eloka. And all those that live outside the land, as if they have no God. So that's part of the harsh statement already. To say that a Jew, rabbis, scholars, for the last 2,000 years, giants of Torah, these rabbis, Talmud Bavli, as if they have no God. Again, as if. It says ki'ilu. Islacha. For it says domeh. Domeh k'misha eino. As if is likened to one who has no God. Certainly I have a God. First of all, God is not limited to in space and time. God is not only in Eretz Yisrael. But we're talking about, the rabbis are revealing to us how we can link up to God. How we can receive that divine content, energy, good, life. So we'll get there. That's the next line. It's as if he has no God. So that's what this rabbi writes. That's a very problematic quote from our sages. Whoever dwells in the diaspora is like one who does not have a God. He says, throughout the ages, the majority of our people's spiritual luminaries have lived in the diaspora. Can we categorically define them as lacking a God? That's what the rabbi seems to be saying, no? Where do they learn that out from? The pasuk in Vayikra. Latet lachem et eretz Kanaan. I'm giving you the land of Canaan. I'm giving you Eretz Yisrael. Liot lachem lelokim. In order to be unto you a God. There I'm your God. In the land of Israel, I am your God. As if, outside of which I'm not. Maybe we can see explicitly, if you look in the next source, on the right, the Tosefta. Is like the, what wasn't included in the Gemara. In the Braitot, in the Mishnah, the Tosefta printed in the back of the Gemarot, in the back of Avodah Zarah, chapter 5. We'll read the whole thing, but just to get this part. So maybe we'll read the. So in the middle there, it says there when Yaakov makes the promise that I'll when I come back to the Vashavti Vashalom, when I come back to my father's house, which was where? He's about to leave Eretz Yisrael. When I come back to my father's house, right? Yitzchak never left Eretz Yisrael. He says, you're too holy. You're the Olat Tmima. You went upon the altar. You're too holy to go out to Chutz La'aretz. Yitzchak never left. So Yaakov says, when I come back to my father's house, then God will be my God. Also the Abarbanel emphasizes this, that when I come back, the condition is, it's v'shavti v'shalom, when I come back, If then, no, then Vayashem Elokim. Then God will be my God. And it says in Vayikra, Latet lachem et eretz Kanan liot lachem Elokim. The pasuk we just read in Ketuvot. I give you the land of Israel to be unto me a God. Kol zman shatem ve'eretz Kanan. When you're in the land, Hareinu lechem Eloka. I am your God. As long as you're in the land, I am your God. You're in line now with this receptor, two pieces of metal. The divine comes down, so to speak, halfway, and now if we're in Eretz Yisrael, we link up and now have put our, the other side of the faucet, or the tube, the pipe, in line with the divine pipe that comes down through the land of Eretz Yisrael. Again, not that God is here. God is not limited to any space and time. But like we said, to bring that infinite to the finite, there's a bridge, a ladder. Right? Like the Yaakov also, that dream, when he says that. When he wakes up and he says, this is what? The dream of the ladder, right? The angel's going up and down, and he says, wow, I didn't know. This is a holy place. And this is Shara Shamayim, the gate of heaven. And the rabbi, there's a whole book that explains how literally the prayers, how they go up through. All the prayers of America and South Africa don't go up to God. What do you mean? They're praying to God, no? We'll see later what's the significance of the prayers in Chutz La'aretz, what ramifications this had. It's awesome. It's so. But anyway, they go up through the gate of heaven. This is where the gate of heaven is. And then they all go up through the... This is how God's content can be revealed, connected to us, how we can link up. So when you're in Eretz Yisrael, as long as you're in the land, Ani lechem, Ari lechem, look, I am your God. Ein latem be'eretz Kanaan, when you're not in the land, Ani lechem eloka, I'm not your God. So we'll see, we'll take the... if you have any, let's just read the source to the end here, because I don't want to leave it in the middle without the first one explanation at least. So they bring now this verse in Vayikra. I'm giving the land in order to be unto you a God. And now the rabbis ask, they understand themselves, this is a problematic quote. How can we say such a thing? How can the rabbi, the Torah, tell us that it's as if there's no God outside the land of Israel? The kol she'eino dar ba'aretz, ein le'eloka? Rhetorical question, statement. And all those that live outside the land have no God? Can you say such a thing? Ela lo malacha, rather, you're right. That's a strong statement, a harsh statement. To say such a thing. He that lives outside the land, they have no God. But rather, it's coming to tell you, kol adar b'chutz la'aretz ki'ilu oved avodat kochavim. It doesn't mean what you thought. It doesn't mean that as if he has no God. It only means that he that outside the land, all those who live outside the land, as if they worship idols. Oh, that's much better. Much more lenient. All those that live outside the land, everyone who lives outside the land, kol adar, as if he worships idols. Ki'ilu, again, as if. He doesn't get the stoning punishment, he's not whatever, for idol worshipping. But the rabbis say unequivocally the statement that it's as if he's worshipping idols. The question is how? What does that mean? How can they say such a thing? And what are they telling us? Not just to say, oh, that doesn't apply, that's in the time of all these different, maybe... I would read to you what the possible explanations are of some people to shrug this off, and not many people read the end of Ketuvot. It's the end of the Gemara, it's the Agadah. So disregard this. We don't have to explain it. It can't be. You see that the rabbis here living and doing fine. Don't they know this source? Don't they know that as if they're worshiping idols? It can't be that it means what you think it means. Therefore, so what does it mean though? So let's, again, these are the words of Chazal. Like angels, Ruach HaKodesh. So what are they telling us? And we'll see later how significant and how the ramifications on the positive side, not to denigrate, to look down and say, the people outside of Israel are worthless. The opposite. Well, I should emphasize already now that this is not an individual distinction. In other words, that the judging individuals, that they're less rabbis, they're less holy, they're less religious, they're less Jewish than a Jew in Eretz Yisrael. This source is revealing to us the reality that they're in. What is the distinction, the objective distinction of the presence of a Jew in the land, outside the land? What is lacking? And the opposite. What is gained by our presence in the land of Israel? And this is so significant now in our day that we're coming back to the land. What does it mean? What are we coming back to? Just to be here? Just to have another mitzvah or a secular state? Or what does it mean? What are we building here? What are we changing of all of creation? When there's a Jewish nation back in the land, there is this universal threshold of energy that changes everything. The whole world is now different. And that's what we have to understand. The rabbi will see, as we understand this meaning, what the rabbis are telling us, the grandeur, the fullness, the exposing to us, the deeper meaning of the presence in the land of Israel. And therefore, they do it in the way of also the converts, by what is lacking outside the land. But from that, you also understand what is gained by our presence here.